Okay, let us reach steady state. Let's reach this steady state. Now we are in radiation. There should not be any time required to reach steady state. Okay. So getting back, so I said this is the Planck's distribution. So this was the Planck's distribution. If I plot this, I am going to get, let me repeat this at the cost of being repetitive. This is y-axis is emissive power, spectral emissive power, and x-axis is wavelength, and each legend is temperature. So this is what I want to tell. Another thing, I keep telling this in the class also, somehow I miss that. Any graph I show in the class should first be told what is x-axis. This is what I have learned from my teacher. What is x-axis? What is y-axis? What is the legend? That is first thing we should tell. That is what I have done now. So if you see here, what we see here is there are no contributions other than ultraviolet, visible light and infrared towards thermal radiation. Okay. So then there is, I do not want to spend too much time, there is only one point I want to harp on is there is the peaks. If I join the peaks, if I join that line can be represented by lambda maximum T equal to a constant, and which happens to be 2897.8 micrometer Kelvin, and this is what is called as, what is this called? Wien's displacement law. Okay. So I think with that we will move on to, this is Professor Wien again. So he has also got Nobel Prize. I said radiation is full of Nobel Prizes. So he has also got Nobel Prize for his work. Is, I think so. It is getting displacing towards the, as the temperature is increasing, the peak or the location or the wavelength at which my temperature, the emissive power is maximum is getting displaced. That is perhaps, I do not know. I have not read anywhere specifically written that. Yes, Saket? What is the physical significance of Wien's displacement law? See, perhaps I think with this law he could predict the sun's temperature. He could predict the sun's temperature. This all happened independently, you know. Planck did this work independently. Wien independently did this. Wien perhaps did not get the distribution, but he got independently lambda max into T equal to that constant. This was all independent observation. I would think why we attribute so much significance for Wien's displacement law is that, Professor Arun can add on to this, is that he independent, everyone at that time was trying to predict the sun's temperature, and they knew the wavelength range for the sun's emissions. So around that wavelength range they could predict, they knew, everyone knew it was around 5000 plus temperatures. Of course there were uncertainties in the temperature measurements, they had different methods. I do not know myself exactly how they measured the temperatures and how they had that data, but they had the temperature data of the sun, and every theory, whichever theory was proposed, was checked only with one check, that was the sun's temperature. Why? Because high temperature data was simply not available to check their theories. So that was the minimum thing what they could check. So to answer your question, why we attribute so much significance to Wien's displacement law is, after you have Planck's distribution, it appears pretty trivial. But what if someone has found it independently? That is what it gives so much significance. That is what it gives so much significance. That is what he was, one of them were asking. He was, Hemant was suggesting that, is it because the peak is getting displaced with the increase of the temperature? That is our guess only. I am not too sure about that. No. Lambda max T, the peak is getting displaced with the increase of the temperature, that I can see from that relation itself. Na? I do not have to see the Planck's distribution for that. Yeah, let us see when did they get the Nobel Prize. This guy got in 1911 and Planck got in 1918. That is true, that answers it. But Planck gave from, in fact Professor Bhandarkar derives this, My name is Professor Bhandarkar from Advanced Thermodynamics class. Saket should remember this, or Sandeep if he has attended. He comes from fundamental Boltzmann statistics and derives this Planck's distribution. One can derive this. He derived from the theory of quantum theory, photons. My electromagnetic wave, instead of wave theory, he adopted quantum theory, wherein which my energy is being transmitted in the form of packets. That was adapted and he could come up with this relation. Okay. So that is why both of them got Nobel Prizes. Yeah. So to answer your question, so it tells that's the best part of putting the historical perspective. That is, Wien's displacement law was found much ahead of Planck's distribution. So that's why it carries so much significance. Okay. Now, if I integrate this for the whole wavelength, I am supposed to get back my sigma t to the power of 4. Okay. So, but then historically it didn't come this way. Sigma t to the power of 4 came first. Sigma was figured out by Boltzmann later on from Boltzmann statistics, and then everyone was convinced about 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8. Okay. So now I think with this we can move on to what is band emission. That is, to make our calculations easy, in today's world I do not know whether this band emission concept is important or not, because I can just apply Simpson's 1/3 rule. Because if someone is interested in fraction of the emissive power between a wavelength 0 to lambda as opposed to 0 to infinity, that fraction, this fraction in today's world I can numerically integrate in my calculator itself. So I do not have to really use these tables, but I think these tables were generated when computers and calculators were not there and logarithmic tables were used. So what they have done is they have defined fraction 0 comma lambda. What does this f 0 comma lambda represent? Fraction of the total emission from a black body that is in a certain wavelength interval. That is all it is. So if I, this is e lambda comma b d lambda, this is sigma t to the power of 4. So I do mathematics, I just take lambda t equal to m, d lambda t equal to dm, d lambda will become dm by dt, my limits also will get changed. So f of 0 comma lambda will become 0 comma lambda, 0 lambda t to blah blah blah. I then put e lambda comma b pi I lambda comma b, this is Planck's distribution, wherein which I have put pi inside. So f 0 comma lambda, 0 to lambda can be seen as a, all the circus I am doing essentially to see inside the integral as functions of lambda t. That is all I am trying to do. So once I do, I get that as a function of lambda t. Once I get that function of lambda t, so it is just a representation. This is the emissive power of a black body varying with a wavelength. This is the fraction I am trying to represent. This shaded portion divided by fully area under the curve is what is I am talking about as f 0 to lambda. Okay. So this, if I put that, again coming back, f of, if it has to be, okay, that was for 0 to lambda, lambda. If it is between lambda 1 to lambda 2, I can write this as 0 to lambda 2 minus 0 to lambda 1. Okay. So that is, this figure explains or tells us how to visualize this. So now I lambda comma b, this is just to put the in tabular form, I lambda comma b is emissive power upon pi. So this equation upon pi, again if I see, this is again brought in the form of lambda t as a function of lambda t. Now I can compute at any temperature, I can compute, and that is for a given lambda t, these are computed, these integrals are computed and kept. So that is, for a given lambda t, I have fraction between 0 to lambda t, and I have I lambda lambda comma b lambda t upon sigma t to the power of 5. Okay. This is put in the tabular form. I think you can all see this, and this is very nicely put in one problem. If you solve this problem, you will be able to appreciate how to use that table. I know I have gone rocket speed, but there is no concept involved here. So that is the reason why I have consciously gone fast. But in main workshop, we will have to solve this problem. All the problems in the main workshop while teaching itself will be solved. In tutorials, the problems will be different. Okay, that is just to make sure that, but please ensure that everyone will have calculators, will have calculators and hopefully the notes material with them. Let us see how do we go about that. Yes, we will try to upload it a week before so that you can have the complete information. They can have a printout as I said with one side for notes making. Okay, so but you have to monitor them, you have to be with the what you say militarily, you will have to monitor them. Okay, so fine, surface emission, now ideal thing is over, now we have to get to real surfaces, because no surface, I do not say no surface is a black body. I over coffee there was a discussion going on, how do we get black surface. I did share this information, but I guess I need to tell this for everyone. So typically I said the black body is generally created by I create an emissivity of 1 by having a cavity, but other way is we try to make a perfect emitter. Perfect emitter is by making, by painting plate by putting black paint. Typical black paints what we use are matte finish. We use these paints. Why I am saying this, because I want to give one suggestion in your experiments. That is why matte finish, any paint, earlier Asian paint used to come, nowadays that paint is not coming. Matte finish black, any supplier paint, black paint, okay. And it is good to paint not with the brush, but with spray painting, so that it gets uniformly distributed. Otherwise, very very traditional is lamp black, that is you put your plate over the candle. Candle is again a diffusion flame, lot of soot will be generated. So if you put the plate over that candle, reasonably thick candle with a thick wick, you will be able to generate more soot, but you will have to ensure that you uniformly run over the plate so that you get reasonably good black. And of course blackboard paint, but we have to be little careful when we are using blackboard paint, because nowadays many blackboard paints are having that glaze, so that the reflectivity is there. So what I was trying to say is that I see in all of your setups, most of your setups you have very similar setup like what we have, that is you have a real surface and a black body. So you get the emissivity one way. Nowadays in India we are able to get Chinese make thermal guns, thermal gun, so which will give the directly the emissivity. I will try to get Saket, get that thermal gun today after evening, we will just show that. I will show you the thermal camera and the thermal gun what we use for measurement of emissivities. So you can go ahead and use that, if that is giving the emissivity, you can vary the temperature and get the emissivity as a function of temperature, number one. Number two, you can cross check your emissivity measurements, whatever you have done with the other method. So that way you would have introduced them to thermal camera. Thermal camera, as I was saying, one of you asked what is a thermal camera. We use thermal camera. Thermal camera also will be brought in the afternoon. I will show you what is a thermal camera. Thermal camera is nothing but a small resistance, but then there are multiple resistors. Okay, let us come to multiple resistors little later. There is a small resistance. So when thermal radiation occurs, that is when it is, when it, some energy is incident on it. So what happens? My resistance increases. That resistance increase is a measure of heat flux. It only measures the heat flux. It does not measure anything else. It only measures the heat flux. So if you know the emissivity only, you can get the temperature. It is again, heat flux is what? Professor has been telling, heat flux in radiation is emissive power. So that is equal to sigma T to the power of 4. So sigma epsilon T to the power of 4. If I know epsilon, the measured emissive power, whatever it is in terms of voltages, actually it will be, but inbuilt there are some nowadays programs, it will do the calculation and give us, if provided, if I give the emissivity, if I give the emissivity. Okay, so we need, but now in a thermal camera the beauty is that now we duplicate that. That type of resistors plenty are there. How many it can be, typically how many Baba? 240 by 360, if my memory goes well. So many pixels are there. You use pixels, you know, in the camera technology you use pixel, 10 megapixels you use that. Similarly, in thermal camera you have that many thermal resistors, and each thermal resistor, imagine each thermal resistor should not talk with the another thermal resistor. That is where the micro machining comes into picture. That's where micro machining comes into picture. So many 320 by 240 pixels are embedded. So if you take a plate of this size, so you can resolve it in 320 by 240 pixel. So each pixel depends, the size depends on your size. If you are measuring this plate, you can as well go up to as much as 1 mm or even less than that. Okay. The point is, you try to purchase the thermal gun. If someone is having a money to the tune of 2 lakhs, that is enough to purchase a thermal camera in today's world. If you want any information on that, I would be happy to share that information. And it is a good idea to have thermal camera in each of our institutions. It gives you surface temperature. That is all it is required. Wherever you, why do you use thermocouple? For your convection, we use in convection, we use for convective measurement, we use temperature measurement. If I maintain a plate at a constant heat flux boundary condition, how? By voltage and current. And if I measure temperatures, I will get my heat transfer coefficient. So radiation can be applied to measure heat transfer coefficient. Okay. So I mean, what I am trying to say is, thermal camera alone makes us understand emissivity much more. Otherwise, emissivity is a very abstract thing. That is the reason why I am saying, at least we understood emissivity reasonably well only when we started measuring things with thermal camera. Okay. So anyway, at the end, maybe if we get time, I will share some information about emissivity measurements in fire and all, what we do, but that will be at the faggest end, not anywhere here. Okay. So I do not want to bore anymore. Fine. Coming back. So what is that we are doing is, so emissivity is radiation emitted by a real surface upon radiation emitted by a black body at the same temperature. What is kept same? Temperature. Okay. So this is the spectral variation. So emissive power of a black body is this, means real life thing is going to be spectral variation, it is going to be there, and also it is going to have what does this right hand side figure suggest? Directional dependence. Okay. So there are various definitions. I am going to go not very fast, but I am not going to derive them, write them, because Professor Arun has spent already ample time on this. So I do not want to harp anymore on this, because he has told what is spectral, what is directional. So spectral directional emissivity means emissivity is a function of wavelength, direction theta comma phi, and naturally it has to be function of temperature. Earlier we had fixed the temperature, now temperature also I have embedded. For a given temperature, emissivity is equal to intensity of radiation emitted by real surface to that of black body. For black body, I am not writing theta comma phi. Why? Because it is diffuse, it is independent. So this, I guess we can understand I lambda comma E lambda comma theta. Okay. Next, what is total directional emissivity? What does total mean? It has been averaged for all wavelengths. So it has to be have only directional dependence. So epsilon theta, subscript we use only theta to suggest that it is having directional dependence. Theta is theta comma phi comma t equal to I e theta comma phi comma t upon I b t. Lambda I have thrown because there is no wavelength, I have integrated over complete wavelength. Next is, what is next? Can anyone explain? Atul Patil, will you please explain me what is spectral hemispherical emissivity? Spectral means, yes, but it is hemispherical means it is integrated over complete hemisphere. So theta comma phi complete theta 0 to pi by 2 and 0 to 2 pi we have integrated. So that is why we are writing, if there is no directional dependence, I do not have to use any longer intensity, I can use emissive power. That is why I have written E lambda lambda comma T upon E lambda comma B lambda comma T. Okay. So one can relate spectral hemispherical emissivity to directional emissivity. So if I take spectral hemispherical emissivity, that is E lambda lambda comma T, so that is, how did I write this equation? Where did this come from? This is the equation. Spectral hemispherical emissivity is epsilon lambda lambda comma T equal to E lambda lambda T is the integration of all. So similarly for black body, it is integration of all, but only thing is that this I lambda comma B lambda T is independent of direction. So I can put that out of the integral, but I will put it in the numerator because I can take it wherever I want, because I can pull it out of the integral. So I put it upstairs. This if I integrate, I will get something, but what is this? What is this alone? I lambda comma E lambda, that is a spectral directional emissivity. So that is what is epsilon lambda theta phi T. If for a minute, if I assume that it is independent, this is all again hypothetical, it need not be that way. If it is independent of phi, I can take 2 pi outside. Why? Because here also I get 2 pi. So if I do that algebra, I can show that epsilon lambda, that is hemispherical emissivity, is related to spectral directional emissivity this way. Okay. This derivation ensures that we have understood the definitions properly. That is all, nothing great. And of course, I can have integrated every way, that is wavelength wise and also direction wise. Total hemispherical emissivity, you can write this equation. Okay. So because there is no direction now, so I will have only epsilon lambda. This can be derived the same way what we derived here, okay, if you really want. Okay. So now we can go, fine, rest is now just doing the calculations whatever we have done. So if I have to get average emissivity, if I have spectral emissivity like this, how do I average them out? What does this transparency tell? Now I will start asking questions, because we have given all basic principles. Now I will randomly pick anyone and ask questions. Okay, Shiblamon, can you tell me what is that I am doing in this transparency? See, what is this figure saying? It is having an emissivity 1 near about. See, I am having red colored spectral distribution. I am assuming that it is constant up to 0 to lambda 1 like this, and there is again lambda 1 to lambda 2, it is again reasonably constant, and then again lambda 2 to lambda, it is constant. I have broken it into 3 portions between lambda 1, lambda 2 and lambda, it is up to lambda, that is to infinity, that is the range. Okay. So now, because question is, where do I get this type of things, where do I get this type of things, emissivity, we can get this. Don't think that this is just like that generated. Actually there are spectrometers, I also learnt very recently. There is something called as FTIR spectrometer. FTIR spectrometer, it will measure and give me, don't ask me how it measures because I don't know. So it will give me the emissivity as a function of wavelength. It can give in fact transmissivity and reflectivity also. Okay. In fact it doesn't give emissivity directly, sorry, it gives transmissivity and absorptivity. Transmissivity usually for all rough surfaces, for all solid surfaces is 0, it actually gives reflectivity from which we will infer absorptivity, and from there we will say that it is emissivity. You will understand, I will again broach up this issue when we introduce absorptivity, transmissivity, reflectivity. But what I am trying to say is this, I want you to emphasize, maybe by main workshop I will put a small cap here and say what is FTIR, I will try to put a cap, but what I want to emphasize is that this is not out of the world picture. in real life, one can measure emissivities, spectrally varying emissivities. Okay, so that's what I wanted to emphasize. It's not just for the sake of cooking we are cooking. It is indeed like that. So sometimes you want to measure emissivities of diesel. Sometimes you want to measure emissivity of petrol, liquids also. I mean, we should not imagine all the time it is only solid surface. It is possible even for liquids and gases. Definitely, it is possible. Okay. Okay. So, yes, someone asked a question. Is that okay? Or the question is, how can one measure gases? No, the gases is if it becomes participating only. Air, reasonably, it is not participating. It is participating with a short wavelength, but that can be neglected. Okay. That's how thermal camera works. Thermal camera is seeing a hot body, but in between, what is there? Air is there. Because air is reasonably non-participating, thermal camera is able to see the hot body. Okay. So now, what am I doing here? I have to write emissivity equal to Eb lambda upon Eb, isn't it? That is, emissive power of the real surface is epsilon into Eb lambda, right? But between 0 to lambda 1, epsilon 1 constant. So that's why I can pull that out of the integral. So this is spectral variation and this is averaged over, because 0 to infinity na, the black body. So that is how, and this ratio we have already put that as fraction previously. So within each wavelength range for lambda t, I can get this fraction. If I put those fractions, I can get, for a given temperature, I will get lambda 1 t, I will see that table, I will get that fraction. Lambda 2 t, I will get that fraction. Here 0 to lambda 2 t, f 0 to lambda 2 minus f 0 to lambda 1. And here again lambda 2 minus infinity, how will I do this? F lambda 2 minus infinity, how will I do that? 1 minus, area under the integral is 1, 0 to infinity is 1, f 1 minus of f 0 to lambda 2, if I do that, I will get that. So that is how I am integrating and getting this emissivity, and as I said, it is coming out through FTIR. Saket, please note down, Baba, I may forget. I have to add this here, FTIR. What is an FTIR spectrometer? Okay. Fourier transform infrared spectrometer. Oh, okay. I remember. How does it work? Okay. How does it work? FTIR spectrometer works on Planck's distribution. Okay, it occurred to me. Good. I was unhappy with myself. Okay. So FTIR spectrometer, what is Planck's distribution? This is my Planck's distribution. Using this Planck's distribution, therefore FTIR, my temperature has to be fixed. Therefore, my FTIR, my temperature has to be fixed. So independently it measures the emissive power by a sensor, and on the right hand side now my temperature is constant. And now for each lambda, I can compute the emissive power. So it is essentially working on Planck's distribution only. It is working on Planck's distribution. In fact, I should be quoting another example, what I came to know through Professor Ramakrishnan. They use FTIR spectrometers in satellites. Why? Because if they put FTIR spectrometer in satellite and take the satellite picture, what do they see? They see all soils, no? All rocks. Which mineral is there is where they will identify through a concept of emissivity, image processing. They do image processing because ISRO always, we see in one of the objectives, identify the rocks and various minerals. I used to wonder how they will figure it out. I learned through Professor Ramakrishnan.
FTIR is to find out the functional group of any.
That is another. I will come to that. I will come to that for gases. Here I am in solid. Okay.
If you want the functional group of any compound, where is the solid one?
No, no, Professor. Actually, FTIR for identifying, if what Professor is trying to say is, FTIR is also used for, we are digressing, but that's okay. FTIR is also used for exhaust gas analysis. For example, IC engines exhaust gas. You want to know how much is CO, how much is CO2, how much is nitric oxide and all. FTIR Fourier, for each sample, there is a standard signal, standard FTIR spectrum which is fixed. If you get CO, if you say CO, they will match with the CO spectrum. If they will calibrate the FTIR with CO alone, CO2 alone, NO alone, then you can see each one. That is for gases, that is for gases. But what I am trying to say here is for solids. Yes, for solids also, they will generate inbuilt, they will generate library, but that is coming from the concept of, that library is coming from the concept of emissivity. This is how emissivity is useful in various situations. Okay. Anyway, thanks to Professor Ramakrishna. Okay. So, and of course, FTIR spectrometer is very expensive. It costs near about 75 lakhs. Okay. It is very difficult to have. But if you want to do any FTIR spectrometry, we have SAIFE, Scientific Analytical Instruments Facility, sophisticated analytical instruments facility. If you send the sample, they will not charge you more than 1000 rupees or 1500. You can get it, FTIR spectrum you can get. What I mean is, if you are taking a black surface, if you are very much in research mode and you want to show your students real spectrum, you get that black surface once taken FTIR spectrum, that spectrum you save it with you. Spectrally averaged emissivity, you can spectrally average it and get the emissivity. With the gun you can get the emissivity, another method you get another emissivity. So different methods, you have shown them how to see the emissivity. In all this, remember, there is no directional dependence. I am telling always the normal emissivity. Is that okay? That should be in the back of our minds. Okay. So see, what I am trying to say is, when you do experiments only, you will learn the concepts better. Okay. So that is the reason why I am giving you so many ways of measuring emissivity, so that you can reach your student very fast. If you show him FTIR spectrometer rather than giving him this cooked problem and ask him to average it, he will understand, okay, this is how I need to apply it for my real life case. Okay. So I think we can help you. If you need any help about SAIFE, if you go to SAIFE plus IIT Bombay in Google, you will be landing in SAIFE website. Yeah, I think I can write that. SAIF, Sophisticated Analytical Instruments. They have seen it. You have seen it?
No.
But virtually you can send the sample, you do not have to physically come. You can send the sample, they will send you. It is just one spectrum, they will scan you and send you. That is not at all difficult. Okay. So I think we can all afford 1000-2000 rupees. It is not at all difficult. It can be done both, not only for solids but also for liquids. But for gases it becomes involved. Let us not get into gases. Yeah. So now with this, let us move on. With emissivities, of course, here it is quite difficult to offer explanations, although I am going to do hand waving only, honestly, because I cannot go to refractive index level and explain things. Okay. It is observed that, let me tell, it is observed that emissivity of non-conductors are generally higher than conductors. Okay. Maybe because the refractive index is better in a non-conductor, I do not know, let me not offer any plausible explanation, but all that I can say is that this dependence of emissivity with a conductor or non-conductor can be explained through refractive index. That is all I think I can offer you. Okay. So because it is quite difficult, we will have to go to, see, let me show you, if I have to really show you what I mean. See, what MODEST does is, you see. this, let me remember this page number 101. If you see, let me spend some time here, so that at least we can offer to that extent what it is. See, if any light, electromagnetic wave can be thought of as an optical light. If any light passes through, I will have, when it refracts, I will have a real component and the imaginary component, N and K, N and K. Now, what he is trying to show through various models, which I am not trying to show, is, you see here, reflectivity here, rho is reflectivity. Let me come down little more, then you can see. Reflectivity, this is rho is reflectivity, his notation, emissivity. Emissivity and reflectivity, for example, this reflectivity is a function of refractive index. So basically, this, all these properties are going to be functions of refractive indices. That is why now I realize why people have catalogs of refractive indices for various materials. This is true for liquids also, this is true for gases also, okay. And it so happens that these models work so well, it is not that it is simply a model. See, these are the experimental results and this is the model. It is not that it works all the time, but reasonably these models are working. But the point to carry home is that the emissivities, reflectivities, transmissivities, they are all functions of emissivities, reflectivity, transmissivity. Although I have not introduced, I am assuming that you know that, but we will come to that. Emissivity, reflectivity, transmissivity, absorptivity, they are all dependent on refractive index, okay. For soot particle also, for a soot particle also, they give N and K, that is the real part and the imaginary part. From that only one estimates the emissivities and the reflectivities and transmissivity.
What is the meaning of refractive index?
Yeah, I think. Yeah, please go ahead.
When light is incident upon the surface, it has certain reflection inside it and it makes certain angles, that is known as reflection angle.
That is it here.
And based upon the different angles, we might have proposed the refractive index of the different material. Mm-hmm.
See, what is happening?
For example, refractive index is 1. So, I don't know what about this, but the refractive index is 1. We will use the formula.
No, it does not refract. It only means that it does not refract. The incident angle is equal to the refracting angle.
It will not make any angle.
Yeah.
And simply pass through the normal. Hmm. But if the material is there, it has certain refraction inside the material which creates the angle, and because of that, the refractive angle concept comes into the picture for different materials.
You want to add something? So, what now I think it is like this. So, what is happening? Electromagnetic wave. If it is passing through a medium,
yes.
If it is passing through a medium, what is happening to it? It has to undergo scattering, it has to undergo reflection. So, this scattering, how much it scatters and at what angle it scatters is what it is deciding. You are getting my point? Are you with me or not? Can anyone elaborate what I told? Maybe instead of myself telling the same thing again and again. See, I am having all, let us imagine.
It changes its direction while passing through the medium.
Hmm.
It is no longer be a straight line.
Yes.
If it is having the refractive index not equal to 1.
Correct.
If it is equal to 1, it be a long
straight. It indicates how much it is getting scattered. It is getting how much it is scattered. That is the reason why all these properties are being explained through
refractive index.
I think to our students, if we tell this much only we can offer. I do not think we can, because I do not think it is possible for us to go back. We can do that modeling, but for advanced heat transfer courses perhaps, but not to derive this and show that for this material, this is going to be N1, N2, it becomes, we will be cutting him off from this. But I think we can just explain that it is a function of refractive index, because electromagnetic wave is moving like a light. And how much it gets refracted is an index of how much it is getting scattered, how much it is getting reflected, how much it is getting.
This diagram itself, I think you can show. Actually, we have not shown this ever in class. So we can this itself, we can say, as he said, how much is that bend? That the bend is the measure of refraction. So for a light ray, we are able to understand. Or when you put a spoon in water,
spoon in water, we are able to understand that, right? It's a bend. So that bend is a measure of refraction. Now extend that concept to electromagnetic waves. It will not pass through normally, meaning normally is not the right word, normal is perpendicular. It will not
without getting deflected,
attenuated or refracted, whatever. So that property by which the electromagnetic wave is changed, whatever way you want to call it, that will be governed by the nature of the material, which is called as a refractive index.
I think that is the only possible explanation thinkable. I mean, that is the easiest explanation one at an undergraduate level.
See.
Sir, what will happen if the ray is exactly vertical? Will it bend or not? If the medium is changed and that it is perpendicular to that surface.
No, it has to get scattered, no? Even if it is, it has to get scattered.
What is scattering? What do you understand by scattering?
Because if we put the spoon vertically, it looks vertical, and if you put it inclined, it seems to bend.
It looks vertical, but is the height the same?
अगर vertical डालेगा तो भी bend दिखता है sir.
Even
if you put vertical, it will bend.
Virtual height, we have studied, no? Virtual height.
How do you explain
all these emissivities?
Actually,
how do you explain in your classes? This is what we attempt and we try, and that's where we stop in our classrooms here.
Scattering in a medium, scattering may happen.
That's true.
But refractive index comes into picture where the medium gets changed.
Yeah, here also medium is getting changed, no? Because it is coming on to my plate. For example, if I take a plate, it is coming on to my plate.
Then it refracts.
Yes, that's what we are talking.
When it takes place, then it is traveling in same medium, scattering outward. So scattering, you cannot compare with refractive index.
He is saying within air itself.
Scattering
will occur. Like if I shoot a beam of light, a torch.
For solid surface, it is quite difficult to explain, but I was visualizing that for gases which are embedded with various soot particles, for example. But if I have a flame in which, that is what I was visualizing, but of course, it becomes difficult for solid body to tell. You are right, for solid body, scattering cannot perhaps occur.
Blue sky in the morning, red sky in the evening, the scattering of light. Scattering of light only, nothing else. Because of heat band and heat band, the scattering.
I don't see the light.
That is again participating, but my air is participating, but here how to tell it for solid body. Fine, I think we will stop here, because the tools what we have in our at our end are not sufficient to explain everything. That much we should admit.
Do we verify scattering in solid? We don't have scattering in solid, sir. Scattering is only in gases.
You are right. Let me think. Maybe before.
No scattering.
No, you are right. Scattering cannot occur in
solids.
It cannot occur in solids. Okay. I will stop here, because I don't think I have any closed form answer for this. So I don't want to go overboard and tell we don't know, but definitely we don't know, that much I can tell. Okay. So, but it is quite difficult. All that I suggest is that we will say that we can explain it through refractive indices. That's what is being done. That's what we can tell and be done with it. Otherwise, we cannot explain any of these, why it is increasing, because students are going to ask me why it is increasing, why it is decreasing. either with temperature or with wavelength. I cannot explain otherwise. Okay. All that I am going to take the recourse is that it is dependent on the refractive indices, and the how the refractive indices vary, that is how these are going to vary. Of course, I am hand waving now here.
Refractive indices for this liquid, gaseous, solid, for everyone, but scattering is only for gaseous.
So here we are talking is about, yes, refractive index.
That is applicable to all.
Yes. So we are talking here about only of refractive index. So here we are saying that all that we said is that all properties are functions of refractive index. So then I think that much only we can offer. I don't think I, yeah.
This just as we are discussing, I thought of this question. If you have plain water, if you keep it in a vessel and we shoot light through it, a beaker for example, we will be able to see the light at the other end also. Slowly decrease the temperature of water and it is starting to form ice. It has not formed ice fully, it is starting to form ice. Then our, it is the same water, chemical composition, but we start to see less and less of the light at the other end, and when it is full ice, hardly anything is also visible.
So probably ice is a perfect, what is ice? Perfect black body.
Light.
Visible, in the visible region, yes. So what, that example is always quoted in textbooks, color is not an indicator of black body. Ice can also be a black body, that is what is. So color, we should not go by the color of the body through visible as through naked eye, through naked eye. Okay.
Refractive index is defined for the transparent medium.
No, I cannot take any more questions on this because I myself don't know. So we are simply hand waving, we are discussing on something what we don't know. So I am just taking, I am just telling, I am just suggesting that we can perhaps explain through refractive indices, and I have not done my homework properly. So I don't know, that is the best thing. But definitely without the knowledge of the refractive indices, we cannot explain any of these. That is all I can say. Okay. So let me see, before our main workshop, can I cook some one or two examples to explain this. Okay. Okay. So now with this we will come to, okay, now the concept, I think I can now go fast, because we know that anything which is G means, professor has taught us that it is irradiation. Anything which is irradiating can get transmitted, can get absorbed, can get reflected. So if we do the budgeting, G equal to G absorbed plus G reflected plus G transmitted. If I divide it by G, this is G abs by G is absorptivity, reflectivity, transmissivity, sum of all this is 1.
If you do energy balance budget for this, which term would be E in, which would be E out, which would be E generated?
E stored.
E in is G.
E generated is G.
There is no heat generation.
E stored will be absorbed.
Absorbed.
No gender.
Great.
E out.
Fine. So now we have. For opaque surface, generally all solid bodies are opaque, so tau is equal to 0, so alpha plus rho equal to 1, rho is reflectivity, and if my surface is reasonably diffuse, then I can neglect the reflectivity also, so then I can get the absorptivity, but then I am interested in emissivity. So I need some other tool to tell me how to link this absorptivity to emissivity. So before I come to that, whole lot of definitions are there which I defined for emissivity, on similar lines you can define absorptivity, reflectivity and transmissivity. I am not going to do that, I am not going to do that because they are in the same lines. So there is no point in doing the same thing.
Word of caution, is whatever be the subscripts and the whatever be the subscripts
and the terms inside the bracket, dependence, same should be there in the numerator and denominator. Okay, so apples and apples only have.
What professor is saying is, if I am using I here, here it has to be I. It cannot be E here and I here.
If top is lambda, bottom also has to be a lambda wave. That means it has to be a wavelength specific quantity.
Okay. Okay. So another important thing is that the absorptivity. Absorptivity is dependent on, there is a basic difference between emissivity and absorptivity. What is the basic difference of about the temperature dependence on emissivity and absorptivity? Emissivity is dependent on the source temperature, but the not the source temperature, on the temperature which it is emitting, which is being emitted. But for the absorptivity of a surface is dependent on the source. That is, let us say here, this is a good example. If you see, if there are emissions by building, there are emissions by sun. Okay. So here sun is sitting at a temperature 5780, but building is sitting at temperature 300 Kelvin. For the emissions due to building or from the building, the absorptivity of my surface, that is the concrete, is again is 0.9. But on the other hand, for the emissions which are coming from sun, which are at higher temperature, the absorptivity is 0.6.
So it also depends upon the wavelength.
No, this is here I am not talking about the, okay, that way wavelength, yes, wavelength of the source. When I fix my temperature, wavelength band gets fixed because my thermal radiation band gets fixed. So point is, the absorptivity of the surface depends on the conditions of the source. This is very, very important point. Why? Because in Kirchhoff's law, I am going to say emissivity equal to absorptivity. But people say, even in Kropra's thesis, that is the most abused equation. Because when I make emissivity equal to absorptivity, as you saw, you will be able to measure absorptivity. Now you want to infer emissivity, but we should take care that whatever absorptivity you measured at whatever temperature should be the same. At the same temperature only, the emissivity will be equal to absorptivity. If it is a different temperature, emissivity and absorptivity are not same. This point has to be emphasized. That is the reason why I have put this transparency here. We have to revisit this transparency when we teach Kirchhoff's law. In Kirchhoff's law, we are going to do that hypothesis and going to say that emissivity equal to absorptivity, and of course we write within the bracket temperature T, but it will not get registered in our mind, because we always say, okay, I got absorptivity by Kirchhoff's law, absorptivity equal to emissivity, but it is not so. So we have to be careful, because in experimentalists also usually make this mistake. Why? Because we tend to make this mistake because for measurements, you measure the absorptivity usually with the spectrometer, which is at the room temperature, because FTIRs usually do not work at high temperatures. You have to do some jugglery to get it at high temperatures, but you want to use that emissivity at high temperatures, because radiation is usually used for higher temperatures. So, but we tend to assume this absorptivity, whatever we have measured, equal to the emissivity which is going to be used for higher temperatures. So we need to emphasize on our students that this emissivity and absorptivity can be equated only at the same temperature, but the absorptivity is the function of source temperature and the emissivity is the measure of, or it depends on the temperature of the surface from which the emission is occurring. Yes. Yeah. How can I answer? Can anyone answer this? How can we answer?
My question.
Yeah.
Depends upon the wavelength which is received. And if the temperature is different,
so
wavelength received will be different.
This is a difficult question to answer. Yes, professor.
My green flow is lambda m to t equal to constant. So when the temperature is high of the sun, the lambda m will be in the short wavelength. So actually it is monochromatic emissivity or monochromatic.
No, but the question is, my surface, it is coming onto my surface. Is it not dependent on my surface at all then?
Sir,
But we are saying is correct, but then why it should be dependent on the source?
No, you are talking of a, see, you are talking of a specific lambda, but at a, if I fix the temperature,
fix the temperature, I get a band, I get a range of lambdas which I have to deal with. I am not fixing my lambda max. I have a range of lambdas at a particular temperature. Now, even I have this question, I don't know the answer. So why should a concrete roof absorb something from the sun differently than something from a building? Or
why do you say absorptivity is monochromatic?
No, why monochromatic?
You mean it is a function of wavelength? Yeah, it is function of wavelength. Then we are on same page. Yeah. I don't think we can make that type of conclusion because you are trying to see from wavelength.
If we answer in that way, that absorptivity is a property of the material, and if the same material has been exposed with the source temperature like 300 Kelvin, it emits less. But if it is having the
here you are just taking this example. It may not be true.
This example only. Suppose the roof is considered as 300 Kelvin, it emits less as compared to when it was at 5780. It means that the stored energy will be higher than that of this out of this.
No. See, it's fine. I don't think we need to answer all questions. Let us carry back home for the sake of record. For the sake of record, I am recording this and we will continue this discussion on Moodle. I am noting down two questions today. In this, we have not answered these questions convincingly. That is question number one. How do I explain the emissivity variation? Emissivity variation of conductors and non-conductors and other variations, I would say. We can say in general, how do I explain the emissivity variations? Again, next question I would say, emissivity variations with lambda and temperature, how can I explain that? Number one and two. Number three, why is absorptivity function of source temperature? Why it is? These three questions we are carrying back home. Okay, and another thing I wanted to tell you is definitely while reading you will get enough questions. Already I have a mail from Professor Gaitonde sitting, why no questions,
why no discussion.
So you have seen that, I guess. So we would encourage you, urge you, implore upon you to throw questions at us. Not that we will be able to answer all questions, but we will start discussing on the discussion mode in Moodle before December. But before December, we should have answers for all these questions.
Answers
also should be there. And at least that is a forum wherein which we can all discuss. Otherwise, who will I ask? Okay. So let us. So this is an opportunity to answer these questions.
In fact, I have put UNG as a person to whom to ask these questions.
We will definitely ask our colleagues. We will read. We will get back to you. But at least we need to. We know now know that these questions have to be answered. Is there a, yes, sir? What, please. Okay. Let him complete. Okay.
It will not depend on the source temperature, whether it is a surface property. It will depend on the surface condition. Same material may have a high value of absorptivity for a certain wavelength, and it may have a poor.
You are telling again the observation only, sir. No, you are not telling why. It is not answering the question.
Observed
it. See, question is, you are right. question is why so? We are going to the root of the matter.
No, it's a band.
See,
so that is why.
This band is completely inside the sun's band. 500 kelvin will be a small band. 5800 kelvin will encompass a large area. 300 is already inside that 5800. No, it cannot be answered that way. Here it is. We can consider the maximum amount of energy towards the peak. Let us see. At least that's not convincing to us, but definitely see. We need to, because we are all teachers, we can appreciate our problems. We need to appreciate that these are the questions to us. Over a period of 3 months, I'm sure one of us should be able to come out of this, come out with an answer. Let us see who will come up first. Okay. So, yeah. What do you mean by thermal radiation and solar radiation? Why is solar radiation different from thermal radiation? No. Radiation is radiation. In both the places, we mean what? In both the places, what are we trying to utilize? What is the radiation we are interested in? Solar radiation is the term used for the radiation coming from the sun. Acha. Okay. What is the question?
He is mentioning about the wavelength.
Okay, let me read that. I have brought Chengal because since yesterday so much of Chengal was going on, so I have brought that Chengal. We will see what is that statement and see that. Okay. As I understand, solar radiation is the radiation from the sun onto earth. That is solar radiation. That's the understanding I have. It will have its own wavelengths and all. Of course, there is a clouds and all. They are not participating so much. Thankfully, that is why we are able to get the sunlight. Okay. I am going to stop all questions and I am going to move ahead. With only one point I want to emphasize again, human body is made of water. So emissivity of water is 1. Okay. So I quote this example always in the class. Predator movie I always quote in the class. Okay, not always, anytime when I remember. I don't know how many of you guys have seen the movie Predator. So in the movie Predator, the hero, I don't know who is that hero, hero kills that predator only through that infrared, because the predator sees the human being as a thermal picture. It sees only the color. So he will close himself with some leaves or something so that mud, so that there is no thermal picture. Basically, he makes himself emissivity zero. The point here is my body emissivity is 1. I can measure the body temperature very easily with the thermal camera. When I am using thermal camera, when that fever was there, what was that fever? Some fever was there, no? When swine flu. When swine flu was there in all airports, if you have seen NDTV or CNN, IBN, you would have seen everyone watching. No, we are watching on the passengers through thermal camera. We are watching the temperature. We are monitoring or quarantining the people who are having swine flu. How did they find out? Through thermal camera. Why they could measure through thermal camera? Because the body emissivity is 1. Whoever is having temperature more than the normal temperature, 33, 34, whatever, they were sidelined and brought back to doctor. We could exploit that without intrusively. I mean, it's not, you don't have to put a thermometer. Imagine you measuring temperature with thermometer with all guys in the airport. It's difficult. With a thermal camera, you could just measure and figure out who is having flu. Okay. So that's another advantage. I quote this example. Why? Because we can relate the utility of emissivity easily.
How beautifully he has brought in a movie concept to explain emissivity. One of the few people who analyzes movie from thermal
transmission. No, actually this is, when I saw the movie, perhaps I didn't know what is a thermal image, but off late only I realized that okay, that was this. Okay.